I want you to imagine for a moment a family with five boys in it. The four younger boys are a bit wild, maybe disrespectful, a little out of control. The older brother is the good, studious, obedient, never breaking the rules brothers, as oldest kids often are. You oldest kids can all be excited now. The parents go away for the day. It's near the 4th of July, and, you know, firework laws have been relaxed in Michigan, so four of these boys go out and they get their bottle rockets. And they decide it would be really fun to launch them at the cars that are driving by, because who knows what could happen. And so they do that while their older brother is inside reading a book, a theology book, we'll say. He's a good older brother. The parents are gone for a couple of hours, and the boys have lots of fun shooting bottle rockets at these cars hidden among the bushes. And then their parents come home, and the boys don't recognize their car, and so they launch away at mom and dad's car. Dad pulls into the driveway. To say dad's angry might be an understatement. To say that steam is coming out of his ears would not be figurative. It might be literal, as blood vessels are popping in his head. And wrath rains down on these boys. Their older brother, who's busy reading his theology book about grace, perhaps, hears the chaos outside, and he comes outside and he stands between his dad and his four brothers and says, "Dad, it was awful, but I love them. I'll take the punishment for them." And so he gets sent to his room for a day, maybe the whole summer, let's be honest. He's in his room a good long time. Now imagine you're those four boys who have been shooting the bottle rockets at the cars going by. How might you feel about your brother in that moment as he's stuck inside in timeout for your sake? Do you worry a little bit that maybe mom and dad will change their mind and decide that this is not such a good idea to punish the innocent child for the sins of the guilty? How do you feel the moment your older brother is let out of timeout and you know the punishment is really done? That you're free and you're in the clear. This time in the midst of the brother's punishment before he's set free, that's the awkward moments between Good Friday and Easter Sunday. That's where the disciples live in those moments. That's where we live until we grasp the meaning of the resurrection. That Jesus died on the cross and he paid the price for our sins, but we can't be sure if it's really enough until we get confirmation. This is part of what we believe when we proclaim that we believe in the resurrection, that we believe in the ascension, that Jesus now sits at the right hand of God. We'll think about each of those days as we consider together Ephesians 1:15 through 23. Hear the word of our Lord for us today. For this reason, Paul writes, "Ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all God's people, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way." This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we reflect together on your word today, as we seek to understand you more fully, we ask that you would speak, words of your truth and life and hope, that we might leave this place transformed and changed by your Spirit. We pray this in his name. Amen. The historicity, the factual proof of the resurrection is vital for the life and vitality of Christianity. If Jesus wasn't bodily raised from the dead, if the disciples only had some warm, fuzzy feelings toward each other because of how close they were to Jesus and their shared mutual experience, which is what some modern New Testament scholars try to argue, if that is the case, then we're really a bunch of fools, aren't we? Because if Jesus wasn't raised from the dead, he may have been a great moral teacher, he may have been a really good man, but he cannot have been our Savior. He just couldn't have been. He cannot have been the Son of God. But if he was raised with a new sort of body, but still a real physical body, then he was who he said he was. He can't just be a moral teacher or a good man that we admire. He must also be our Lord and our God, and we need to submit to him. In the past, I've given reasons for why we should believe in the resurrection. We won't go into that today. If you're curious about the factual reasons why we can trust it, because honestly, if any historical event that's happened in the distant past, including Hannibal attacking Rome and the elephants, who heard that story and had it taught as fact in your history classes and in school? Hannibal comes and he attacks Rome. Ancient history, you should have gotten it in school because it's in every history textbook. You should be raising your hand, right? Who's ever heard about the Trojan War, right? You've heard about that, right? You all think that happened, right? There's more evidence about the resurrection of Jesus than either of those events that are taught as factual history in our history books. I'm not saying they didn't happen. I'm just saying there's more evidence of the resurrection than of those events that we all assume to be true. So if you want to look into that, I have some references for you. You can read them on your own time. We won't go into this today. But if you want to read a short book that kind of addresses the arguments people make against the resurrection, The Case for the Resurrection of Jesus by Habermas and Lacona is great. If you want to read a really long book and learn everything you could about what ancient people thought about resurrection and death and life after death, you can read The Resurrection of the Son of God by N.T. Wright. It's 700 pages. Have at it. It's a great book. It is really good. You should read it if you have time. Or you could read The Evidence for the Resurrection by McDowell, or Did Jesus Rise from the Dead by William Lane Craig. Those are great shorter books as well. Or if you don't like to read, who here sometimes doesn't want to read in the middle of the summer? I sometimes don't want to either, right? So if you don't want to read, there's a sermon called The Spirit Hath Not Flesh and Bones by Timothy Keller. If you search for the whole thing, A Spirit Hath Not Flesh and Bones by Timothy Keller, it will show up number 4 on your Google search results if you have the same search history that I have. I don't know if it changes based on what your search history is. So that's what showed up for me under Redeemer Sermons. You can download it and listen to it in your car. It's 45 minutes. So if you have a 25-minute commute, it's one day back and forth to work, and you got it. So you don't have to take any extra time in your life. Just don't listen to the radio on the way. Listen to Timothy Keller preach at you. So you can do that if you're interested and want to know more about that. If you don't want to read or listen to sermons and you want to talk about it, you have questions, I'm happy to talk one-on-one about it with you and try to answer some of those questions for you. But today, rather than arguing for why we think it's true, I want to talk about, given that it's true, what does it mean? What's the significance of the resurrection, of the ascension, and of Jesus being seated at the right hand of God? What does it matter? I'll suggest today that there's 3 reasons why the resurrection of Jesus matters for us, and then we'll look at 3 reasons why the ascension matters. First, because of the resurrection of Jesus, we are made right before God. Paul puts it this way in Romans 4, verse 25. I think we can get up there. Thanks. He was delivered, meaning Jesus was delivered over to death for our sins. So Jesus died to pay for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. Justification is actually a fancy Greek word that we translate as just, as justice or justified or righteous or righteousness. It has the sense of being in court and having the judge declare that you're right. And so what Paul is saying is Jesus took the punishment for you, but until the judge says you're right, you're still not free to go. And so Jesus' resurrection is proof that we've been made right with God. It's like if you pay off your debt to the bank, your debt is paid, but until you get a written confirmation that you no longer owe on your mortgage, you can't be sure if the bank got the information. That's the final confirmation that it really happened. It's kind of like with little kids. This morning when I got up, I was in Eliana's bedroom, and last night she didn't want to go to bed very quickly, apparently, because she was making a guitar by tying strings from the door of her closet to the blinds and strumming on them, apparently, to make a guitar. I don't know about you, but in my house, when you yank hard on blind cords, they break, and then the dad has to replace them. I'm against that. So I found her, and I sat down with her, and I said, Eliana, it's not okay to tie strings to your blinds. They could break. And I thought I did that very kindly and calmly and compassionately. It was not heard that way by my daughter because she did what little four-year-old girls do when they think their dad doesn't like them anymore, and she cried. And then I felt about this big. But I still stuck to my guns because seriously, you can't tie string to blinds and then strum on them, right? You can't do that. It's bad. But from Eliana's perspective, she and I were not good. Even though she didn't even get punished, I just told her not to do that again. We were not good until I picked her up and held her on my lap and hugged her close and told her I loved her. Because that's what little kids need to know, that mom and dad love them. No matter what the punishment is, whether it's a big punishment or a little one, for a little kid, the fact that they got in trouble means the relationship is at stake and they need the physical reminder that you're still in relationship. That's what the resurrection is for us. It's the physical, historical reminder that our relationship with God has not been destroyed because of our sin. That Jesus paid the price, and he has restored that relationship and made us right with God again. The resurrection reminds us that that is indeed true. That's the first thing. The resurrection reminds us that our relationship is restored. Second, baptism points us to the second thing that happens in it, that the resurrection does for us. The imagery of baptism works better if you're not in a sprinkling church. So we're in a sprinkling church, which means that we go over here when we baptize people, and they get like 8 drops of water on their forehead. And it doesn't really do much. Unless they're really little and I get too much water, sometimes they cry. But it doesn't really matter, but you can't get the image. But if you go to a church that has a tradition of immersion, of putting you all the way under the water, you get the other image of resurrection. Because what we say in baptism is that we have died to our sin. So you go under the water because from a Jewish perspective, water is a place of chaos and death. So you go under the water, you physically, literally from their side, die to your sin, and then you are raised back up to a new life. And baptism reminds us that because Christ was raised, we too will be raised. Paul puts it this way in Colossians 3, 1 through 4. He says, since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things, for you died. We died with Christ on the cross. That's what baptism means. Symbolically, we die with Christ on the cross. And your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. We are no longer a people ruled by the values of this world, but we are governed by the values of heaven. In the resurrection, we are reminded that though we were dead in our sin and we have now died to our sin, as Christ is raised, we are raised. And we can now begin to live a new life. Our past life of sin does not get to define who we are. As Christ has a new life, we have a new life, and we are now new people that God is doing something new in. Because we have communion, we have union with Christ. What happens to him happens to us. We die and are raised with Christ. That's the second benefit, that we are raised to a new life as he is. And then third, in Romans 8:11, Paul says this, if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of his spirit who lives in you. What Paul is saying is that if you have the Spirit of Christ in you, meaning the Holy Spirit living in you, then you can face death without fear. But because just as Christ was raised from the dead, by that same Spirit, God will raise you. The resurrection is the promise that one day we will be raised too. It's the first fruits of the resurrection to come. Some of us have grown up in church, And we've just come to take this for granted. We've known this hope for so long that we don't really think about it anymore. We can no longer remember or imagine what life and death would be like if we didn't know that death doesn't get the last word. If we didn't know that God will speak again and raise us up. One of the privileges of being a pastor in our community is that funeral homes occasionally call and will ask myself or Pastor Rick to help out with a family that doesn't have any church home, doesn't have any connection with really God in any meaningful sense, and they need someone to officiate at their funeral. So we'll go and we'll walk with the family and we'll talk with them and we'll plan a service and we'll think about how to help them make sense of what has happened. And it's fascinating walking through, it's painful, honestly, walking through those days with these families because they don't have any hope. The hope they hold on to is that their loved one will live on because they remember them and they won't forget. But then they live with the fear, but what happens if I forget? If I forget what their voice sounded like? If I forget what they looked like? If I forget their sense of humor? If I forget that? And they carry that anxiety. What happens if we forget? Then they don't exist at all anymore. They're filled with doubt. They're angry often. Confusion, but mostly they're scared. They're afraid of death or of the unknown, of being alone, that someday they'll be forgotten too. Then I compare that experience to walking with many of you in the last 10 or 11 years as you've walked through the valley of the shadow of death. We've gathered by bedsides with your parents or your spouse, and we've prayed together. Often we've sang hymns together. Or praise music together. And I'm struck that for almost all of our members, as they face the end of their lives, they don't face death with fear. They don't look forward to it. They would prefer to be alive rather than to die. But they don't face it with fear because they know that if Jesus was raised, they will be too. That if death could not grab hold of Jesus and keep him, then Jesus won't let death grab hold of them either, because God will raise them up too. And there's a difference when we know that death doesn't get the last word. The resurrection reminds us, gives us hope, that death doesn't speak last because God will raise us up again. Of course, it's not just that we think Jesus was raised from the dead. If we stopped at Jesus was raised from the dead, there'd be an important question for all of us right now, which is simply this: if Jesus was raised from the dead and didn't ascend into heaven, where is he now? Right? Because then he should be right here so we could talk to him. Because he was raised from the dead, he hasn't died, so he should be somewhere. But the disciples are absolutely clear that after 40 days, meaning a complete amount of time, because 40 in Hebrew languages means completeness, the fullness of time. So 40 days or somewhere close to 40 days, Jesus ascends into heaven with his body and leaves. He still has a body, but now he's in heaven with God. He didn't become some sort of spirit. And that's why we now, if we're being careful theologically, we never say that Jesus lives in our hearts, because Jesus has a body and bodies don't fit in your heart, do they? We say the Holy Spirit lives in us. Scripture is clear. Spirit lives within us. His Spirit lives within us. That's where we get some of the confusion. But there's benefits to Jesus' ascension. It would be nice if we could see Jesus. Wouldn't that be cool? I mean, if Jesus came every Sunday and preached in church, would anyone doubt the resurrection? It would be pretty awesome, wouldn't it? And whatever church you was at would make the big mega churches look pretty small now, wouldn't they? Because what church would you go to other than the one Jesus preached at, right? That would be pretty cool. We'd all go. I'd be at that church too, in the front row every Sunday, fighting you for that spot, right? So there must be some benefit we gain from Jesus ascending into heaven, because there's clearly a loss, because we'd all like to touch him and talk to him face to face, wouldn't we? So there must be a gain that we get. Why did Jesus leave? There are three reasons I suggest that why Jesus leaves. First, because when Jesus ascends into heaven, he goes to sit at the right hand of God so he can argue our case to God. Imagine for a moment you had a friend who worked in the White House, and every day he walked into the Oval Office and he talked to the president. He got to influence national policy. And they got to influence what laws would be supported, what laws wouldn't be supported. They got to influence national security kind of issues. How cool would it be that if you could call that person and get your voice heard in the Oval Office? Wouldn't that be cool? I mean, there are some really wealthy people who are paying millions of dollars every year in our elections so their voice can get heard in the Oval Office. It's worth something, isn't it? It's worth a lot. What the Ascension reminds us of is that we don't have a voice in the Oval Office. We have a voice at the very right hand of God in the throne room of the King of the universe, arguing our case every single day. This is what Paul says in Romans 8:34. He says, "Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us." So this is what you got to imagine. Every day when you're asleep, Jesus is sitting there talking to God, saying, "Hey, God, do you remember Jeremy? You know, he had a rough day yesterday. Let's help him out. He has a slow start today. Let's let him sleep through his alarm clock today." Because Jeremy needs extra sleep every once in a while. I know you got to work out. It's 5:30, but sometimes you got to sleep in, right? Or, you know, Sally, she's been really struggling with her boss. Let's see if we can get a transfer at work so she gets a new boss. Or, you know what? That, you know, our friends Bill and Susan, they're struggling with their bills, but we know Jerry over there, and he just got that bonus, and he's generous. Let's put it in his head that he should give something to these people that we love because they need the help right now. And every day, all day long, Jesus is pleading with God for what you need in your life before you ever ask. That's the benefit of the Ascension. Every single moment of every single day, you have Jesus arguing your case to God. Before you pray, Jesus has already asked God for what you actually need. Jesus is there every moment of every day pleading your case with God because he's got God's ear, because he ascended into heaven. Second thing, Christ ascended into the heaven to the very presence of God, and because of that, just as we are raised with Christ, because we have union with Christ, we die with Christ, we're raised with Christ, somehow we ascend with Christ, and so we're in the presence of God too, even now. Not fully, because you're here, but somehow we're also in the presence of God. Just as we are already now somehow raised, and we're already now somehow dead to our sin, even though you all keep sinning, right? Yeah, me too. Right? But we know it's also true. We're dead to our sin. We're raised with Christ. We're somehow in the presence of God. That's what Paul says in Ephesians 2:4-6. Says, "But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace we have been saved, and God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus." This is weird theology for us because we think that it all happens in the future, right? That someday we'll be with God, someday we'll be raised. But Paul teaches that somehow we've already experienced all of that because of our union with Christ when we're saved. Somehow we're in the presence of God, which is why when you pray, you're not making a phone call. Have you ever been in a youth group and they use the illustration of, you know, you pick up the phone to call God, and they'll even say when they pray, who's going to dial and who's going to hang up? Because that's who starts and that's who ends the prayer. That's so bad. Because it implies that you need a phone to talk to God because he's far away. The image we're given in Scripture is not only that Jesus is at the right hand of God pleading our case, but we're right next to Jesus, so you can talk to God, not because he's far away, but because he's right there. You don't need a phone. You don't need a mediator. You're already in his presence because you are united with Christ, and he's already listening to everything you say and do all the time because you're in his presence all the time, as Christ is. Because where Christ is, we are, because we've been united to him through his death and resurrection. Second benefit, you're always in the presence of God. Third benefit might take a little lead up to it. So, have you ever forgotten your wallet when you went out to eat? None of you, but I have. When you do that after, when you notice it after you've eaten the meal, it's a little awkward. Because you've eaten the food, you can't give it back now. They don't want you to do that, but they do want their money. So you have to go home to get your money, but they don't know if you're going to come back. So they ask for something to guarantee you'll come back. Thankfully, now we have cell phones, because before it might have been your wedding ring. Now they ask for your cell phone, which it might be safer to leave your wedding ring given what's on your cell phone, right? But you leave your cell phone behind because they know you won't give up your cell phone because it identifies everything, and how are you going to call anyone? No one knows phone numbers anymore. Right? So you'll come back for it. It's the deposit, the guarantee that you're going to come back to pay your bill. That's what Paul argues in 2 Corinthians 5:5. about the ascension of Jesus, Now, the one who has fashioned us for this very purpose is God, who has given us the Spirit as a deposit guaranteeing what is to come. Jesus goes up to heaven, he tells us, so he can send the Spirit, and the Spirit is a deposit. It's a guarantee from God that he will later completely fulfill all that has been promised through the death and resurrection and ascension of Christ. That we will indeed one day be dead to our sin completely and we won't sin anymore. One day we will be raised with bodies that don't spoil or decay or die. And one day we will be physically in the very presence of God. The Holy Spirit is the promise that God will do that because the Spirit is here in you. It's the promise, the assurance of your salvation. Every once in a while, I'll have someone come and talk to me and say, how do I know I'm saved? We worry about these things. We want to be saved. And so people ask, what do I have to do? How do I know it's really true? And they worry about if they said the right prayer or if they got baptized the right way sometimes or if they've confessed all their sins. By the way, you have not confessed all your sins. You don't even know what some of them are yet. Jesus forgives your sins even before you confess them, even before you know what they are. You can take a breath. Have they confessed their sins? Are they living the right kind of life, or have they committed such bad sins that God won't forgive some of them? And they worry, can they really be saved? But if you look at Scripture, nowhere in the Bible does it say that you have to say the right prayer, that you have to confess all of your sins exactly the right way, that you have to live a perfect kind of life in order to be saved. What Jesus says is, I sent my Spirit as a deposit, as a guarantee. So if the Spirit of God is living within you, you can be assured that you're saved, even though you still screw up sometimes. If the Spirit of God is in you, then you'll be someone, one, who asks, how do I know that I'm saved? Because if he's not in you, you won't care, right? But if the Spirit of God is in you, you'll be someone who wants to know God, because that comes from the Spirit, not from us. If the Spirit of God is in you, you'll want to be in the Word of God, and you'll be able to understand it. If the Spirit of God is in you, you'll have a longing to connect with God and have a deeper relationship with him, because none of that comes from us. It all comes from the Spirit at work within us. Our natural inclination is to run away from God. If you have had any of those experiences, the Spirit's in you. And God is faithful to his promises, and he'll be faithful to you, and he will save. Even if you screw up, and you doubt, and you struggle, and you wander, and you wonder, God won't let go. Because he has given you his Spirit as a deposit to say, I'm coming back for you. And we can be assured of our salvation and live without any of those fear or doubts. So it's this Jesus who was raised and ascended, who sits at the right hand of God, and as some of our passages alluded to earlier today, now reigns over all of the world. And as those who have died with Christ and been raised with Christ and ascend with Christ, we are now called to proclaim the good news that Christ reigns, invite others to live under his authority, that they can receive the same benefits we have from his death, resurrection, and ascension, and experience the new life God offers. This is the mission we've been given. We are the ambassadors of the reign of Christ in our world. Believe this good news and go forth to live in its peace. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you today for the death and the resurrection and ascension of your Son, for the forgiveness he has given us, for the assurance of salvation we have received, for the way he pleads our case to you, for the confidence we can have that we have been made right and our relationship has been restored because of what he has done. And we ask today that we would carry that good news with us, that we would proclaim to the world the good news that Christ has died, but he has risen and he's coming back again.